Welcome to the YouTube channel for Bible Biker Church in Rockwood, Tennessee. I am Fred Marshall, Elder and Associate Pastor. We pray that what you're about to see is inspiring to you as it is the truth in the Word of God, as it is written. We pray that it blesses you and anyone that you share it with. If you like what you see, please click on the like button and subscribe to our channel. Also know that you can find us on Facebook under the page name Bible Biker Church. Thanks and have a blessed day.
Love offering today, and thank you and praise you for the opportunity that we have today to do our outreach with other ministries, Father God, that we can have other Christian leaders come into our group, Father God, in your house to give your word, Father God. Lord, just we pray that the Holy Spirit will just move through each and every one of us, Father God. And Lord, we just thank you for this opportunity that we have to work with others, Father God. Lord, you're an awesome God, Father. We just praise you for everything you do in our life. We pray that this message that is given today, Father God, that you will just allow us to step out of your way and that you'll allow us to be receptive to the message, Father God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We've got a little encourager out there today. He's saying amen. That's his
I want it contagious in here. We are going to call on the Spirit. We're going to bring Jesus into our hearts, feel the Spirit, and then we're going to dance. We're going to have an upbeat song at the end. But I want it to get radical in here. So let's have a good time. You stand up and join me for this morning's worship.
Jesus. are yours. We want you. We want you. Come and consume, God, all we are. Give you permission. Our hearts are yours. We want you. We want you.
Even mountains move. Yeah. time it's so strong, and then other times, like, it isn't that strong. It's like you go to service, and it's like you're right out. And sometimes service goes longer because we are stewarding His presence. And that's what God wants to teach us today. Learn how to steward His presence so that we can experience more of Him. So I want to pray.
Briefly mentioned it earlier, but I want to give you again going more in depth of who the Father is, who the Son is.
is and then who the Holy Spirit is. Because some people teach, I don't believe this, and I'm going to break it down to you and show you how they are three in one. But some people would teach that they are all separate. Some would teach that Jesus is a prophet, even though he's not. He is God. He is he is the Savior of the world, the Son of Man. And so we're going to dive into that. But let's first start off with God the Father. I want you to say this after me. God the Father loves me.
God the Father loves me.
I want you to say it again. God the Father loves me.
God the Father loves me.
So God is perfect.
God
is perfect. You don't need to get that. God is perfect. Super duper perfect. He has no sin. He has never sinned. He's never even thought about sinning. Because it's so perfect. But what's super cool about it is that he loved us so much that he came from heaven to die for you and me. He came from heaven so that we could have eternal life with him. And so he loves us so much. And he wants to be a father to us. He wants to have a sonship and a daughtership with us because he loves us so much. And that's who our Father is. But many of us see our Father like some angry person. And when we sin, oh, you lost your salvation. Or you're just trying to live up to the law. And we know we're not supposed to live up to the law because we can't. But in our hearts, we're still trying to do that. We're still trying to live up to all of that. But God is like, no, I love you. I love you. Just fall in love with me. And allow me to change your heart. And allow me to be your Father and heal those wounds. And when he starts to heal our wounds, he starts to heal our scars, what happens is we perspective of God changes, and that's what we need so that we can experience the more of God in our life. The second is, I want you to repeat this after me. God the Son saves me.
God the Son saves me.
I want you to repeat it one more time. God the Son saves me.
God the Son saves me.
Many people would say, well, I know God the Son saves me. But how could he save someone like me? I know God the Father, or God the Son, saves me. How do I just keep sinning and I keep just walking all over his grace? Does his love ever end for me? I've been there many times. I've been where back then everyone was a believer. Nowadays people are actually going off saying they're full out devoted atheists. But for a little bit, when I was a little child, if you didn't go to church, then there was something wrong. And so everyone said they were a Christ follower, but not everyone lived in it. And so they're taking advantage of his grace. And that's a lot of times what we do to Jesus, is we take advantage of his grace. And we don't walk in the fullness of God and the fullness of what God has for us because we take advantage of his grace. And we think, well, I'm going to be forgiven, but I'm still going to be forgiven. And that's not what God wants for us. He sent his Son down on the cross so that we could take advantage of what he did for us. He sent his Son on the cross so that we could live a life not in sin, but a life above sin. Because we have authority. The Holy Spirit's going to give us authority. So that leads me to my next point. Is God the Holy Spirit? God is the Holy Spirit. And so I'm super excited about the Holy Spirit. I want you to say the Holy Spirit empowers me.
The Holy Spirit empowers me.
Say it again. I want you to say the Holy Spirit empowers me.
The Holy Spirit empowers me.
I want you to repeat it after me. God, the Holy Spirit is within me and on me.
God, the Holy Spirit is within me and on me.
So I believe a lot of you would say, hey, I know Jesus. He has saved me and he is my Lord. The Lord is my King. And so, in a sense, the Holy Spirit lives in you. But there's a difference when the Holy Spirit's on you. Jesus said, I have been anointed, and the Spirit is on me. Paul says, I have something in my flesh. I have a thorn in my flesh, but the Spirit came on him. So he can accomplish and he can overcome the things of this world because the Spirit's on him. And he can walk and lay hands on the sick and drive out demons in the name of Jesus because the Spirit's on him. And in him. God wants to consume all of you. He wants to be on you and in you. He wants more of you, but you have to say, okay, I'm going to surrender, and I'm going to give it to you. And so I want you to understand that today, that we must understand who he is. And so if you're understanding someone, if you're meeting someone, you always find out what their name is. And so a lot of people know the Holy Spirit as Holy Ghost or the Holy Spirit. I like to say Holy Ghost sometimes, but sometimes people get freaked out. I teach eighth grade boys, and this past weekend, I was teaching them more about the Holy Spirit, and diving really into all that God has for them. And I was saying Holy Ghost, and some of the kids' eyes got so big. But let me just tell you, God came and met with us one time. We had a small group. I said, you know, we're just going to pray. We're going to ask the Lord to come in this room. And he did. It was super cool because they're all on their faces seeking after God. And it was super cool seeing his presence just fall upon them because they wanted to receive it. And so today, I want you to be in that posture to receive and understand that he wants to give you more and more and more. The Holy Spirit is translated in the Bible over 800 times. And so that is super cool, super important. If God's Word talks about it over and over again, talks about him over and over again, I think that we should want to have a relationship with the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. I really did.
Amen.
All right. I can't say this word, but I want to talk about the interpretations, and I'm going to have some scriptures with it. I'm going to read it, and then you probably can say it, because you know, probably know a little bit of Hebrew. R-U-W-A-C-H. Anyways, that is the Hebrew word, and it is the wind, the breath, and it's talking about the Holy Spirit. That's what it means. And so we can look in Genesis 1, 2. That would be awesome. Now the earth was formless and empty. Darkness covered over the deep waters, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the surface of the waters. This scripture is so big to me. I think a lot of times we're like, well, Genesis is the creation of the world, so cool, you know, let's keep going on. Let's just keep moving forward. This is just something we're going to learn in Bible study, you know. But we're never really going to fully comprehend it, and we won't. But I think that we should be in awe that we can't fully comprehend what God is doing here. It's because he's creating, this is the beginning of the universe. And nothing is there. Imagine nothing there, but his presence is there. There's nothing there, but his presence is there. And so God started with creating the world with his presence, hovering over everything. Before there was any trees, before any of that, before he even had people on the earth or any animals, he had his spirit hovering over. He had his spirit already here. And so that means when Adam and Eve were already, you know, created, when they got created, the Spirit of God was already there. A lot of times we get saved, but we think that we're just left in abandonment. But God's Spirit is already there. God's Spirit is already waiting on you just to come into it. And that's what we got to say. I'm in. I'm all in, Lord. I'm coming in to what you have for me. And then the second one, because I know a lot of us are like, well, Jordan, that's Old Testament. Get to the New Testament. So I have another scripture, but I want to say this word, and I can't say it, so I'm going to spell it, and then maybe someone can interpret it for me. P-N-E-U-M-A. Pneuma. Pneuma? Okay. Just making sure I say it right. So pneuma, it means that, again, a strong breath air. It's about air pushing through, and strong legs. And so it's a Greek word used throughout the New Testament. We can flip in our Bibles to John chapter 6, verse 63. So Spirit alone gives eternal life. Human effects accomplishes nothing. And And these are very words I have spoken to you, by the Spirit of life. And that is so, so, so important that we understand that the Holy Spirit here, the Holy Spirit is moving, that the Holy Spirit is what gives life. It is not our flesh. And it's the pneuma, the breath of life. When we talk about the breath, when we talk about the air, it's the breath. He wants to give us fresh breath. He wants to give us a fresh anointing. And that is only through the Holy Spirit. And that's the only way we can accomplish living a life of power. Let's talk about some natures of the Holy Spirit. And the natures of wind. Wind is unseen. You can't see it. A lot of us say, well, when I can see God, I believe in God. I feel that all the time. When I do evangelism, when I'm going in the downtown, when I'm at my school, and they always tell me, I want to see him. I did too. I want to see him too. But then I tell them I have seen him, and this freaks them out. They're like, huh? But I'm not in a physical being, but I've seen them in a spiritual being. And so it's super cool seeing what the Lord does. But it is unseen. We can't see him. We can flip in our Bibles to John chapter 14, verse 16 through 17. I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advisor. And he will help you, and he will be with you forever. The Spirit of truth. The world cannot accept him because they have never seen him or know him. But you know him, for he lives with you, and he will be in you. So powerful. So powerful there. That scripture just really gets me because a lot of times we don't understand. Jesus is talking to the disciples, talking to them, telling them, in other words, he's about to die. And he's telling them, someone is about to come with you. So imagine someone that you love is about to pass away. And they're telling you, they're about to go to heaven. And a lot of times we can't comprehend that. But they're saying, in other words, they would be like, hey, I want to be praying for you in heaven. That's what Jesus is like doing, but he's giving a greater gift than just a prayer. He's giving us the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And that's the best gift that any believer can ever receive. The best gift for any lost person is salvation. But the best gift for any believer is the Holy Spirit. Amen. And so we can't see him. We can't physically see the Holy Spirit, but we can see the works of the Holy Spirit because he is in us and he is with us and around us. And so feelings aren't a bad thing. But I believe that this generation have been so numb to feelings because yes. A lot of people take advantage of the feelings and they're, you know, over or emotional to what God wants to do through them and they miss the fact of truths. But I think a lot of us are too scared to allow God to really touch us and allow him to wreck our emotions that we miss God. We're numb. Amen. We're paralyzed from what God wants to do in our life. And so feelings are not a bad thing. You should be able to feel God. I feel the Holy Spirit. I feel him. I was debating if I was going to share this, and I believe the Lord is going to share it. But there was a time in my life when I felt the Holy Spirit so strong. Everywhere I went, I couldn't go away from his presence. Even when I would go to sleep, I could physically feel the Holy Spirit lay next to me and lay on me. And it was so, so, so powerful. And now I'm trying to get back to that point of walking with God. If I can be straight honest with you, and God told me, you're not asking me anymore to come sleep with you. And you're not inviting me in. And that's what we gotta do, and invite him in. To have us and for us to walk with him even when we cannot see him. That's why it's by faith that we walk. Wind is unpredictable. Have you ever been in a storm and it starts just blowing and you didn't think it was going to blow that hard because you weren't predicting it? Wind is so unpredictable. If we can flip in our Bibles to John chapter 3, verse 8. The wind, P-N-E-U-M-A.
Pneuma.
So if the wind, the pneuma, blows wherever it pleases, you hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it's coming from or where it's going. So it's with everyone born of the Spirit. So the Holy Spirit is with everyone born of the Spirit. But we don't know where it's going. A lot of times people say, well, I believe the revival is going to be here. But we don't know where it's going to take off after that. And so what happens is, well, Lord, I don't see the revival happening. I don't see it actually going out and sparking anywhere. So I guess it's not happening. And then we lose our faith and we lose what God really wants to do in our lives. And then we just kind of go back to the normal routine. And that's not what God wants for us to do. He wants us to understand that our systems aren't going to work. It's His systems and His way. Because a lot of times, this is what happens in the church. I'm going to be real. Alright, with the American church. Well, I've been in Nicaragua and it's a little different. In American church, we worship the systems more than we worship the Creator.
That's true.
We put together a system on how worship is supposed to look, on how the preaching is supposed to look, on how everything is supposed to look. And if you don't stand up to that or live inside of that structure, then you and your church isn't going to exceed it.
Yes.
Or you are never going to experience the more of God. And that's not true. God has a different system. He has something way greater than we could ever imagine. Yeah. And sometimes His system actually changes because we don't know how to stay in His own system. So it looks like He's changing His mind a little bit, but really He has already told you something, but you're just not paying attention to it.
Yeah.
There's been times where God would change my message before I would preach it. And oftentimes, when I look back at it, God actually spoke that word to me. I was just not willing to listen to it. And so He had to really get me right before I got to get on stage. I listened, and He finally said, "Are you ready now? You ready to change your message? You ready to do what I told you to do the first time?" And then you thought you knew better than me. That's what we do a lot of times, if we can be honest. Because God has a set plan. He already knows what's going to happen. And He has a structure that we must get under His authority, not man, and not what we want, what He wants.
Yeah.
So it is unpredictable. And then the third thing is when it's powerful. So powerful. This is one of my favorite scriptures, and a lot of people preach from it, and a lot of people know it, but I don't believe a lot of people really know it in their heart. And really believe it within their heart. So if we can look at Acts 1:8, that would be awesome.
Power because we have a system that's taking away the power of God.
And it's time for us to tear that system down and let the Spirit of God break out.
Right.
And so let's keep reading, because it gets really good. About everywhere in Jerusalem, throughout Judea, Samaria, and all ends of the earth. And that's what we're called to do, take it all around the world. And some of you are like, well, I don't live in Jerusalem, so I'm never going to go there. I'm not in Judea or any of those other places. But it has a word for you too, everywhere else. All ends of the earth, like Nicaragua. You know, I get the opportunity to go to Egypt and all these other places. That's where we're called to go. And I know. Not all of us necessarily are called to go to these places, but we are called to help people that are called to go to those places. And we are all called to make sure that we make disciples in our own nation. And so that is so important. So we all have to take on that anointing and that calling together for us to experience the more of God. And then the fourth thing is, wind is refreshing. So refreshing. I love. After a storm, when you go outside and it's like this refreshing wind, I love not to knock you over. I'm like that. I'm like you're not over. But I like when you're just breathing it. I love the smell of fresh warm. I don't know. I love it after the storm is over. I love the smell of I love just being in the air, the atmosphere. And so if we can look at 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9 through 10. I love the Bible verses, brother, y'all. I love the Bible. Chapter 2, verse 9. So chapter 2, verse 9 through 10.
Awesome.
Alright, what no eye has seen, what no ear has heard, and what no human mind has conceived, the things God has prepared for those who love Him. These are the things God has received to us by His Spirit. The Spirit teaches all things, even the deep things of God. And so it's refreshing. It refreshes us. It gives us more understanding. It gives us a deeper understanding of who God is and what God wants. And there was a time where I really kind of was searching. And I'm honestly still searching because I'm honestly in a season in my life where I don't know where God's really taking me. And I'm trying to just be faithful with everything He said to do. But I really want to know His heart. Because I know a lot of people, you know, talk about, again, I'm going to talk about the word revival, and there really is, I'm really Lord. The Lord's doing a revival here, just want to tell you. But I used to lead a movement called Revival Tour, and, you know, we would have these awesome events, but then I would leave, and I felt like we were missing something. And I was like, Lord, why do I feel like this all the time? Like, we're missing something, and it's just, I don't know, is it just me, or is it just that I'm thinking the system's not right that I'm trying to build here, or is it, what is it? And God has really just spoke to me through this verse that you're not understanding my heart. You're not understanding my heart, the depths of my heart. The Spirit teaches us the heart. It searches all things. It searches the deeps of God, and guess what? That is His heart. And I want to know His heart. I want to be able to speak His heart to His people, because I don't want to speak my heart. My heart's wicked. Jeremiah says wicked. It's so wicked, no man can even comprehend it. That's how wicked it is. And I want to know His heart, and His heart is the deep things. And so it's time for us to receive that and take a deep breath and invite the Holy Spirit into our lives. Now I want to give you a couple points to take away. So we can lead into really the altar call today. But this is it. This is something I really want you to really do for me today, is let go of your fears. Let go of your fears. Just let them go. Proverbs 3:5 says this, trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding, and all your ways acknowledge Him, and He'll make your path straight. So that's Proverbs 3:5-6. And it's so important for us to understand that He is not against you. He is for you. And He knows the plans for your life. He doesn't want them to harm you. He wants them to prosper your life. And And that's what we got to understand. That's what we got to believe today, that God wants me to prosper, that God wants me to accomplish things that only He can accomplish through me. We got to give Him the glory for it. And so it's time for us to understand that I'm not going to live a comfortable life sitting on the sidelines, sitting in a pew. I'm ready to go out and be on the battlefield and run after what God has for me, because I'm not letting fear hold me back anymore. I'm not letting fear hold me back when I'm in the grocery store and the Lord clearly speaks to me to pay for her, to pay for her groceries. When the Holy Spirit clearly speaks to me and tells me to pray over that person, I'm not going to hold back anymore. I'm all in. I'm all in, because I want to see revival go. I want to see revival come. I want to see an awakening come. I want to see God do something that's way bigger than we could ever imagine. Way bigger than we could ever. I want to see something new. I don't want to see an old revival, because that's old. God's pouring out a new anointing, a new wine. He's pouring out something new that God wants to do in this generation, in this now generation, because we are all part of this now generation that goes into it. The second thing is really leading to my next point that I've been saying this whole time is go all in. You'll never find the best life. You'll never find all that God has for you again if you're going one and a half way. You'll never get it. You'll never get to your destination. We'll never get to our promised land if we're not all in. A lot of the Israelites weren't all in. So guess what? They never made it to the promised land. It took them 40 years and walk around, because they just wouldn't go all in. They'd have a little spark moment, oh, I'm on fire, and then 2 days later, they're going back to what they normally do, and that's complaining. The music's too loud, or, oh, I don't like Jimmy's sermon, I don't like this, you know, all this different stuff. I'm hungry, you know. That's what they did. They're complaining, but they don't understand that God brought manna down, and they don't understand that God's doing miracles. God just rescued them and saved them from something, like He does us, and He's pouring out blessings on us, and we just miss it. Because we're so consumed with something very, honestly, very, very small. And we don't even ask God for it, but we just consider He doesn't. We just come to our mind that He's not going to do it, and He can't do it. And so we just automatically assume that, well, I'm just going to stay right here. I'm going to live stuck. I'm going to look comfortable. Because I don't want anyone else to know my problems. Because we don't like to bring the darkness into the light. And it's time for us to be a generation that brings the darkness into the light so that we can live in the light. We don't have to be afraid of it. Jeremiah 29:13 says, "You will seek me and you will find me when you seek me with all of your heart." With all of your heart. When you go all in. When you go all in, you will find Him. You will find the depths of who He is. And this is not a condition. This is not, you can find another way out of this. You have to go completely all the way in to understand Him, to know Him deeper. Because I truly believe, I think it's an American taught gospel, to be honest with you. We think a lot of times we have this, you know, this encounter with Jesus. And we just say, well, I'm saved now. But if you read about the whole Bible, it talks about growing, and it talks about, you know, walking and deeper and getting deeper and knowing Jesus. But I believe many people will say, hey, I had this encounter with you. I said, yes, Lord. But what's going to happen is He's going to look at them and say, I never knew you. You never knew my heart. You never did the Father's will. Jesus said, if you don't do the Father's will, then you're not. He doesn't know you. And I'm not here to tell you it's about deeds. I'm here to tell you, if you fall in love with Jesus, then your deeds will match up to the love that you have for your Father. Amen. The love that you have for your Jesus. Amen. But I'm here to tell you something, though, that I think that we forget sometimes. Is that we don't understand that we got to keep getting to know Him. Keep getting to know Him. If I didn't come, if I don't ever talk to this pastor anymore, guess what? He doesn't really know me anymore. He knows of me. But He doesn't know me. And that's the same thing with Jesus. Yes, Jesus knows everything about you, but he's a gentleman, and He won't force some way into those secret things that you're doing. I heard a pastor say this once, and it's so true. Jesus, when you tell Jesus no to something, like a lot of us do to our finances, or a lot of us do to, you know, the things that we're watching, we say, no, that's, I'm going to handle that. I'm going to do that. And Jesus says, okay, you do that. Why? Because he's not going to force himself on you. He's not going to force you to give that up. He's not. He's going to love you. He's going to be there, and he's going to have his hands wide open. And honestly, we think he says, well, I told you so. But honestly, I don't think he says that. I think he's just waiting on you to come back. Coming back to reality that you need him again. And that's what it looks like to go all in. Is to give him every part of your life. And then develop an intimate relationship with the Holy Spirit. Develop one. I want him to be my best friend.
Amen.
I want him to speak to me. I want him to know me.
Yes.
I want all of them. And that's what we need. We got to develop an intimate relationship with the Holy Spirit. A very intimate relationship with the Holy Spirit. And so my bottom line today, when it comes down to this, is this. The Holy Spirit is a breath of fresh air. And it's time for us to take that breath. It's time for us to take it, to just allow the Holy Spirit to breathe on us. It's time for us to take a breath of fresh air. And I want us to give an opportunity to receive more of the Holy Spirit, because I really feel the Holy Spirit in this room today. And I really feel the Holy Spirit wanting to pour out more of an anointing. This may get freak some people out. But I believe this generation, and I say the now generation because we like to think that older people are in this other generation and that younger people are the ones coming up. But what happens is when we say that, there's a big gap. So we have the old generation, you would say, and then the next generation. There's a gap. And a lot of times young kids say, well, my time ain't here yet. And so there's a gap, and this gap is full of sin. And I'm tired of seeing young kids in this gap die over drug overdose and over depression. And so it is time for us to say, this world is not about me anymore. This life is not about me anymore, because I'm ready to dive into what God has for me so that I can see people healed, so I can see people delivered, so I can see people overcome things that this world is trying to take them out. Because the devil wants to kill them. He wants to kill them. We think that we are just guaranteed life, but we're not. We're not. It's time for us not to be entitled anymore. It's time for us to understand that this life is a privilege, that this life is not guaranteed. We're not guaranteed tomorrow. Only this second. We're not guaranteed an hour, a minute from now, only this second. And this is the time for us to embrace what God has done. I feel led to share part of my story. Because I understand the fact that this life is a privilege, because I used to struggle really hard with depression. And the devil would really try to come and kill me. Like physically kill me. Where I would lose my mind, and I would always want to just drive. This was really one of my plans one time, was to drive to Cleveland, Tennessee, because I knew nobody. And I was going to purposely go into a wreck and kill myself. But I'm so thankful for the people that walked in the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The people that listened, that would call me, the people that would come to my house and show up and pray with me. So thankful for them. And that's who we need to be. That's who we need to be, those people that comfort the ones that feel like they are so lost and feel like they have no hope and no future. And so I want to open up this altar. But before that, I want you to close your eyes and just listen to me. But when I open up this altar, I want it to be for the ones that want more of God. Want more of His glory. And I believe some of you are going to get baptized in the Holy Spirit today. Because we need a generation that prays in the Spirit. We need a generation that knows how to allow the Holy Spirit to fight for us. And I believe that you are going to begin to speak in a new tongue. I believe some of you are going to begin to prophesy. God's going to give you a fresh revelation. You're going to begin to walk in word of knowledge. You're going to begin to have discernment so you can be able to cast those spirits off of them and drive them out. God is moving in this house today. And so I want you to come up to this altar when you feel like you're ready to come and get more of God. So just to ask God to talk to you, to mess with your heart a little bit, and then you come when you're ready. And I'd love to lay hands on you and love to believe the Lord for you.